I want to just go back to 2008 for a moment and just even start with a very big picture sense of it all. What do you think happened that led to 2008?
Well, I think the main thing, but you know, there's all kinds of tributaries feeding into the big Missouri River on this, but you had people think that housing could do nothing but go up, and you had a $20 trillion market in residential housing, and so it was a big, big asset class, and people started using it as a currency, basically, they found out that it wasn't straight up, you know, in the end, they borrowed on them, and there were levels of participation up and down the line. I mean, people at the top were writing mortgages that they knew they'd never have to hold, so they'd sell them to somebody in Norway after they'd been put in a package, and you had people refinancing, figuring that didn't make any difference whether the monthly payments were too high, and you had them lying on loans, and you had the lenders participating in it, and you basically just had a huge speculation in housing, and 50 million of the 75 million owner-occupied homes in the United States were mortgaged. 25 million were free and clear, so they were okay. But you literally had a crash in the value of something that 50 million families owned on margin, had thought were going to go up. They'd based their living standards on it. In many cases, they'd borrow against it. And it was unlike any widespread financial participation, you know, anybody had ever seen. It manifested itself in all kinds of ways. I mean, everybody behaved badly, but they believed, you know, and when people start believing something kind of crazy, you get that sort of thing.
It's early 2008. Hedge funds with a lot of subprime mortgages are going under. There were a couple. At that point, how worried were you? Do you remember being worried?
Well, I wasn't worried because I've always assumed that in a lifetime of participating in the American economy, that it's going to move forward dramatically over time, and also it's going to have a lot of hiccups. And, you know, it's part of our economic system that we will periodically have some craziness go on. And so I don't try to predict markets, or I don't try to predict business. I just try to adapt to what comes along. I did see in the summer of 2008, I got a call from one of the top officials of one of the main Wall Street firms trying to sell us many, many, many billions of dollars worth of equity securities in Freddie Mac, and I knew something was wrong.
So take us back, I don't know if you remember this, this is after Bear Stearns goes down. So this is before Fannie and Freddie,
yeah.
But after Bear Stearns, you get a call from Dick Fuld.
Right.
And he tells you that his stock is getting killed by short sellers.
Yeah.
And
when anybody says that to me, I get very suspicious. I'd love to have short sellers in Berkshire. You know, how does a short seller hurt you?
And he says there's an opportunity for you to invest somewhere between $3 to $5 billion. Are you interested?
I'm interested in hearing him out. Yeah.
And what did you tell him?
I told him, tell me what your ideas are, and I'll do some looking at it. But tell me what you'll pay first. And then I'll know whether I want to do some looking. So he threw out some tentative ideas. I do remember, and actually, he said, can I have Hank Paulson call you? So Hank called about, I think it was 6 or 7 on a Friday night. And then he stopped short of giving a totally unqualified endorsement, but he was probably hoping I was going to finance it, but he wasn't going to try and sell me too hard. He didn't, I'm sure he didn't feel that was right. So anyway, I spent that evening going through there, probably a 10K. I've got it at the office still where I made notes as I went through it. And it was 250 or 300 pages. And I just wrote down on the front page the number of the pages where I was finding problems. And when I go through, I knew that it was not for us.
Because you saw what?
I just saw a lot of things that made me very worried about their financial condition and what would be happening to them under the circumstances that were happening in Wall Street.
Now we're in September of 2008. And this is Friday, September 12th. This is the weekend.
The weekend.
And you get a call this time, not from Lehman Brothers, but from AIG, asking if you'd be interested investing $10 billion in the company.
Yep. I said that, don't count on us. I know time is of the essence with you guys, so just don't waste it on me. So I'm out at that point. Now, they re-enter the picture a little later. But I said, I can't figure this thing out. You know, it would have been 20-some billion dollars. And we could have paid it if I'd known what we were getting. Well, the very fact that they were calling me and, you know, sending out stuff Friday evening at 8 or 9 o'clock in New York indicated they were in peril.
What does a call to Warren Buffett mean, you think?
Well, it means that they know we will act fast if we like something. So we are the best fast buyer for anything that involves in the billions of just about anybody. And they knew I'm interested in the property casualty business in this particular case. And you know that they are desperate for something that's going to close within a few days.
You know, a lot of people still look back at that weekend, and Lehman Brothers in particular, as the moment of the crisis, and wonder whether the U.S. government should have stepped in or not.
Yeah.
The next morning, the New York Times and the Wall Street Journal both wrote op-eds, editorials, praising.
Yeah, sure. That's the way everybody felt. The hell with those guys in Wall Street. We've had enough of them, you know, basically. Long ago, some Fed chairman told me that whatever the Fed thinks it can do, it can do. Now, that may have changed some under Dodd-Frank, but that was the prevailing view of at least one Fed chairman.
So you think the Fed could have done it if they wanted to?
I think if I were chairman of the Fed and I saw what was going on in the United States then, I think I would have done it whether I could do it or not. I mean, are they going to come down? The Supreme Court going to send down some guy to arrest me as president of the Fed? I mean, I would feel it would be an act that I should do in the interest of the country. If I were in that position.
So you think it was a mistake?
I don't know. I mean, because they'd have had to guarantee so much of public opinion. Can you imagine public opinion if all of a sudden, you know, people are losing their houses and facing being underwater on and all kinds of personal problems, and all of a sudden you've guaranteed that everybody at AIG is going to be okay and everybody at Lehman is going to be okay. I'm not sure it would have been. It would have been very tough to do.
How much political pressure at that time do you remember was on both Hank and the Fed and everybody
who
came to bail out?
That was huge. That was huge. I mean, I think that Bernanke, I think that Hank Paulson, I think that Tim Geithner, I think they did an heroic, and I think George W. Bush did the right thing. I think they did. They were heroic. But you weren't going to sell that to the American people.
Lehman files for bankruptcy. Bank of America buys Merrill Lynch. AIG gets rescued. And yet there's still serious anxiety that GE might go, Goldman Sachs, Morgan Stanley.
Well, when Lehman goes, the big commercial paper holders were money market funds. I mean, these things were just hitting one after another, and both Hank and Bernanke had to worry very much about the congressional reaction to anything they did. Congress really didn't get it. George Bush got it. I give him great credit. I didn't vote for him, but I give him great credit for understanding just how big the problem was.
And you get a call later in the week about Goldman Sachs. Do you remember that call?
Well, I remember the call. Yeah. When Goldman Sachs needs money, you'll remember it.
And what did you think?
I did think that we were in very good hands. Congress was the one that scared me. I thought we were in good hands at the Fed. I thought we were in good hands at the Treasury. I thought we were in good hands at the presidency. And I thought that there was Goldman Sachs was sound under any situation except if markets just totally were closed up. I think the unsung hero of the whole thing, although it was a stupid thing to do, I think the unsung hero was Ken Lewis buying Merrill. I mean, Merrill would have been there on Monday morning. I think he got some fairness opinion that said it was okay to pay $30. I think he got it twice between Saturday at noon or something, and the deal getting announced on Sunday morning. Nobody knew what Merrill was worth at that time, but he got the fairness opinion. He said we'll pay whatever it was, $30 or thereabouts. It wouldn't have been worth 30 cents on Monday.
Big mistake then.
Well, it wasn't for the system. And incidentally, Merrill's worked out fine subsequently, but I mean, under the conditions that existed, on Monday morning, if Bank of America hadn't announced that purchase on Sunday, it wouldn't have just been Lehman. The second that Lehman would not have been, if they backed away from Lehman, they'd have to tell Merrill to stand on its own too, and bingo, bingo.
When you look back in retrospect, is there anything you wish that you had done that you didn't do? Any investments that you wish you could have made, given?
Well, I can look back on any week and come up with that. I mean, the situation, we'd have been better off, considerably better off at Berkshire if we waited 4 or 5 months to buy anything. I mean, the low was set in March, and it was much lower than that. I wrote that op-ed for the New York Times in late October. Well, it was right on a long-term basis, but it was way off for 3 or 4 months, 4 or 5 months at least.
Was there ever a moment that you thought that the system would gum up so much that people, I mean, that we would be back in sort of a Great Depression, that there really would be red lines and, people?
It could, if mishandled, it could have lasted quite a while. It wouldn't have lasted as long as them, but it would have really gummed things up, there's no question. They're already gummed up, but it would have, at some point, the government has to step in. I mean, when everybody in the world wants to deleverage, there's only one party that can leverage up. There's just one party. And if for some reason they don't do it, you've had it.
And when you look back now, is there a great lesson, you think, for the public, for new generations of people who are going to hopefully learn about and think about this crisis?
No, because the answer is people have always panicked. I mean, that's why they set up the Fed. We had all kinds of panics in this country in the 19th century. When people are afraid, they are afraid. Confidence comes back one at a time, but fear is instantaneous.
Thank
and,
you.
And it doesn't make any difference how sophisticated people are, whether they've got PhDs or anything else. When they are afraid, they are afraid. I know a number of people that would surprise you who during that panic period subsequently, you know, went right to gold and felt that nothing would be worth anything. And, you know, I mean, people really, fear is extraordinary with most people.
Do you draw any parallel or connection between the crisis 10 years ago now and the politics of today and the distrust of institutions and governments? And
sure. People have long memories, just like they did after 1929. It took a long time. I mean, people, when they've experienced extreme fear, it sears something into them where they want to know who did it to them, and they correctly don't blame themselves. I mean, you know, they're not supposed to be finance experts or anything. All they did was buy a house and lie a little bit on their loan application and get, you know, just figured it was going to go up, and then they'd refinance and so on. I mean, who's going to blame anybody for that?
Is there anyone to blame for the crisis? Because that's been also a political.
You can blame a lot of people for doing very foolish things, but I don't think anybody was. There's a certain number of people who are doing crooked things all the time, and to some extent they were attracted to the real estate market because the money was flowing so easily. I mean, when you can create a mortgage, you know, in in Bakersfield, California, and sell it to somebody in Norway. And then when you get these permutations of these things where you get one instrument that's dependent on another instrument. I made a calculation once on one security I saw that had been raided by the agencies, and I'd had to read 300,000 pages in order to understand both the primary security and then the ones that it was dependent on and so on. And it just gets, you know, and nothing goes wrong for a while, so everybody gets used to doing it. It'll happen again.
Do you worry about another crisis?
Well, there'll be one sometime, but no, I don't worry about it in the least.
Because
I conduct myself, so if there's another crisis, I'll still be around. Berkshire will be in good shape.
What do you look around today and say, okay, I got to be anxious about that?
Well, asset appreciation draws in people that really don't know anything about the asset, and people start being interested in something because it's going up, not because they understand anything else, but the guy next door who they know is dumber than they are is getting rich, and they aren't, and their spouse is saying, you know, can't you figure it out too? And I mean, it is so contagious. So that's a permanent part of the system. But in terms of the specific excesses, I don't see them now. No.
Are we better prepared for another crisis? Do you look at either the regulations
That's an interesting question, because I've never read Dodd-Frank in its full 2,000 plus page. I've read little summaries. I have the impression, and I may be wrong on this, but I have the impression that it somewhat weakens the ability of the Fed to act promptly and unilaterally. And I would say that's a terrible mistake. And we need a powerful Fed. You may not like them, but you know, they may do things that bother you. But you need somebody that, if this country with now $100 trillion of household wealth, you know, with now 75 million plus, that it doesn't come to a stop because everybody's trying to deleverage.
Was there ever a moment in that week where you, either between everybody calling you or talking to you, thought, wow, we really, this is...
Well, I described it actually on CNBC as an economic Pearl Harbor. That's not a term I've ever used before. So, I mean, I felt it was something different than I'd ever seen. And I felt it was actually worse than 29, in a sense, in terms of the immediate panic that was induced. In 1929, if you remember, in September 29, the Dow hit a high of 381, then it collapsed in the fall. But I was born August 30th, 1930, and it was back up to 250-some by that point. I mean, it didn't hit that many people. It hit everybody on Wall Street, but Wall Street wasn't as broad then remotely as it is now, you know, with 401ks or whatever it may be. So this homes, that touches everybody.